I am Dr. Rupa Iyengar. I will be talking about gynecological imaging today. Whenever a patient comes to us, first we will take the history of the patients and then we examine the patient. After examination, we will come to some provisional diagnosis. This is depending on whatever examination findings and history findings we are having. Now, we have not examined the internal organs, nor have we seen the internal organs. Now, it would be very nice if we could see the internal organs. That can help us very much in our management. So, there are various techniques where we can see the internal organs or the images of the internal organs with various investigative methods. Some of them are X-rays, then ultrasound, CT scan, MRI, and PET scan. Now, the X-rays. The X-rays is a technique which is relatively cheap and it is generally available easily. The relative exposure to radiation is less in X-rays. There are various uses of X-rays in gynecology. Whenever we post a patient for surgery, the major surgery, we always want a pre-operative assessment. For this, we advise an X-ray chest of PA view to find out if the patient is fit for surgery. Another use is whenever there is a missing copper T, we take X-ray pelvis. X-ray pelvis is taken with a uterine sound in situ, a lateral view. The lateral view will tell us, first of all, whether the copper T is present or not. Now, if it is superimposed on the uterine sound, then we can conclude that it is in the uterine cavity. If it is displaced from there, it may be anterior or posterior. In that case, we can say that it may be in the myometrium, or it may be partially in the peritoneal cavity, or maybe it is a completely outside the peritoneal cavity. So, X-rays will help us in knowing this. Another method is that histosalpingograph. Histosalpingograph is an X-ray picture after uterus and the tubal cavity is flooded with radio-opaque dye. This radio-opaque dye is injected through the cervical canal, and whenever there is patency of tube, this will go in the tubes and then it will collect in the peritoneal cavity. And the X-rays are taken that will show us the tubes, uterine cavity, and there may be spillage in the pouch of Douglas. And if the tubes are blocked, then there will be no spillage in the pouch of Douglas and tubes are also not seen. Depending on where the blockage is, part of the tube proximal to the block may be seen on the X-ray. Another indication of X-ray in gynecology is to assess the age of the patient in medico-legal cases. Certain medico-legal cases, we need to know the age where we can take the X-ray of the long bones. These conditions are wherever there is a case of rape, or there may be a case of kidnapping, or there may be a case of child abuse. Then, if a patient comes with the dribbling of urine continuously, we may suspect some fistula. In this incontinence of urine, we would like to find out where is the fistula. Is it vesicovaginal or uretrovaginal? In that case, when we do intravenous pyelography, we can see the kidney, pelvis, calyx, and the ureter, and where is the urine draining. So we can identify from uretrovaginal fistula, from vesicovaginal fistula, and it will help us to plan the surgery. Certain cases we need to assess the lymph nodes. In this lymph node assessment, we have to do the lymph angiography. Now, the next technique I am discussing is ultrasound in gynecology. Ultrasound in gynecology is a non-invasive technique. It is based on the echoes produced by ultrasound. These echoes will create the image. Now, there are different techniques: transabdominal, transvaginal, color Doppler, 3-dimension and 4-dimension. Ultrasound are the high frequency sound waves which are not audible to human ears. They are audible to certain other species like bats. In transabdominal ultrasound, we need full bladder and 2.5 to 3.5 meter hertz of sound waves are used here. Often it is used in some mass, abdominal mass. It is used to assess what the mass is. Could be fibroid, could be TO mass, or it could be some ovarian tumor. The transvaginal ultrasound, bladder needs to be empty. The sound waves are 5 to 8 meter hertz. And the organs within 10 centimeter close distance are nicely visualized. The color Doppler creates the picture image in a waveform, and this is very useful to assess the blood flow in certain vessels. This is very useful for us whenever we are assessing the ectopic pregnancy. We want to know the vascularization of ectopic pregnancy. Sometimes it helps us to decide whether we can do the medical management or surgical management for ectopic. Another case is hydatid form mole. After the evacuation of hydatid form mole, when the patient comes for follow-up, she may be complaining of continuous bleeding. Now we would like to assess whether there is still viable molar tissue or not. So when we do this Doppler, if there are vascularity present in that residual, then it is a viable molar tissue. And if not, then there is no viable molar tissue. So when it is viable molar tissue, we may need to use cytotoxic drugs for the treatment. So it helps us in management. Another case is ovarian tumor. Whenever we assess ovarian tumor, Doppler may be used to find out the vascularization. So if there is an irregular vascularization, then that may indicate that it may be a malignant tumor. Now, the 3-dimensional and 4-dimensional ultrasound is very useful to find out the volume. The volume of the, basically in infertility cases, whenever do the follicular study, we are doing the serial study and following the growth of the follicle. We will follow the growth of the follicle till it becomes mature and reaches certain volume and certain vascularity. Only at that point we would like to induce ovulation by giving HCG injection. So it helps us, the 3D or 4D helps us to know the follicular volume. Now, so the pelvic ultrasound is used for diagnosis and treatment and follow-up of certain diseases, and also in certain guided procedures it is very helpful. Now, the organs examined, as I told you, is basically cervix, uterus and ovaries. In the uterus, we would like to know the size of the uterus, all the dimension, anteroposterior, transverse and longitudinal. Then the myometrium texture. Then the endometrium thickness. Then intrauterine cavity, anything is there, like maybe there may be some fibroid, polyp, or maybe there is a foreign body that can be identified by doing the ultrasound. Tubal pathology. The normal tubes are not visible on ultrasound, but whenever there is pathology, like there may be hydrosalpinx or there may be pyosalpinx and tube is enlarged and filled with fluid, it may be visible. The ovarian tissue. Whenever we see ovaries, we again see the size, the dimensions, the volume, the morphology and the number of follicles and the details about the follicles, size and how they grow. The serial ultrasound will tell us the growth pattern of the follicle. Apart from this, very often we need to do ultrasound to know the genital malformations. So various malformations we will know. Then different types of pelvic masses, fibroids, ovarian tumor, endometriosis, malignant masses, we can assess by ultrasound. And missing IUCD, I already discussed on X-ray. Same thing, we can also see on ultrasound whether there is missing IUCD. When patient comes with the history of IUCD, but she may tell that she is not able to feel the thread, or she may give history of IUCD and on examination we do not see the tail of the IUCD. In that case, we can do ultrasound and see whether or not there is this missing IUCD is seen, and if it is seen, where it is. Now, what are the clinical indications of ultrasound? The clinical indications, some of them are amenorrhea, primary amenorrhea or secondary amenorrhea. In primary amenorrhea, the girl has never had menstruation. So we like to do ultrasound to find out whether she is having the genital organs. Is uterus, cervix present? Is ovary present? Okay. If it is present, then why she is not having? It could be that she has something like imperforate hymen or some obstruction for the flow of the menstrual fluid. In that case, we would be able to see a vagina and uterus, or vagina alone filled with blood. So we can see the hematocolpus or hematometra. Then in secondary amenorrhea, she has had menstrual cycles in the past, but now for more than 6 months there is no menstrual cycle. So in that case also ultrasound will help us to know again if there is a secondary obstruction and there is again maybe hematometra or hematocolpus, or there may be no menstruation. We would like to see whether there is any ovarian tumor, because virilizing ovarian tumor or adrenal tumors can cause secondary amenorrhea. So it will help us to assess the genital organs. Then the next very common complaint is menstrual complaints. The menstruation cyclicity may be varying. It may be polymenorrhea or it may be oligomenorrhea, or there may be severe dysmenorrhea, which is quite common in adenomyosis, or there may be heavy flow, menorrhagia. So in these complaints, we would like to do ultrasound and find out if there is any obvious cause. So abnormal uterine bleeding or dysfunctional uterine bleeding where there is a hormonal cause, or there may be polycystic ovary, or there may be endometrial cancer or cervical cancer. So ultrasound will help us to find out if there is any such pathology. Then a patient may come with acute abdomen. In acute abdomen, we would like to differentiate or diagnose whether she is suffering for ectopic pregnancy, or it could be a twisted ovarian cyst. These are the common causes of acute abdomen in gynecology. Or there may be a non-gynec cause which we have to rule out. It could be appendicitis or it could be intestinal perforation. Then a special indication is postmenopausal bleeding. It's very important to do ultrasound in postmenopausal bleeding to rule out endometrial cancer if it is visible. We find out the thickness of the endometrium. If it is more than 4 mm in a postmenopausal woman, then it is definitely pathological, and we have to further investigate to find out if there is a endometrial hyperplasia or whether there is ATPA present or not present. Then another common indication is infertility. Patient who may come with primary or secondary infertility, we will do the ultrasound to find out the uterus, cervix and ovarian status. Uterus may be a small uterus, hypoplastic uterus, or there may be no cervix or some congenital malformation may be there. Ovaries may be streak ovaries, or there may be polycystic ovaries which is causing infertility. Then patient may be having some children, but now secondary infertility. So here again we assess the genital organs to see what can be the cause of secondary infertility. Then a woman may come with a hirsutism, that is maybe hoarseness of voice, or there could be excessive facial hair growth. In these cases, again, you would like to rule out any ovarian tumors. Any androgen producing tumors can cause hirsutism, or it could be adrenal gland tumor. So we like to investigate the same. Now, what are some of the assisted surgical procedures which uses ultrasound? One thing is biopsy. If you want to take any biopsy of lymph nodes, you may want to do under ultrasound guidance. Or there may be aspiration of fluid from the ovarian cyst, which may be done, or maybe aspiration of peritoneal fluid can be done. Or in case of infertility treatment, suppose we want to pick up the ovum, the ovum pickup can be done under ultrasound guidance. Apart from that, even there is a procedure sonosalpingography. In ultrasound also we can test the patency of the tubes. A non-iodide based dye is injected through the cervical canal, and on ultrasound we follow the dye and see if it enters both the tubes and comes out of the tubes. That is sonosalpingography.